Hello, I am Seamus Dunhue of EVE University, and this is Episode 1 of How to Survive EVE Online, as refilmed for the Odyssey expansion. Before I begin, I want to give a shout-out to Paul Suarez Jr., who is the creator of the YouTube video series How to Survive Minecraft. I believe he has since renamed it Minecraft Tutorials How to Survive and Thrive. I highly recommend it. It is his video series that inspired me to create my own videos about a game that I play, EVE Online. EVE Online is a massive multiplayer online game by Crowd Control Productions of Reykjavik, Iceland, also known as CCP Games. It is a deep, complex, space-themed game with a significant player versus player slant, but it also has a fair amount of player versus environment content in it. Traditionally, EVE Online has been very hard for new players to try to learn. However, in recent years, CCP have made significant improvements to the new player experience and to the initial tutorials. The purpose of this video series is to show the game off to people who have never played the game before, and to let you judge for yourself how easy or hard it is to get into the game and decide for yourself whether or not you actually want to try it for yourself. There are many different things that you can do in EVE Online, but they all start with getting an account, logging into the game, and creating your first character. So after you've logged in and you've seen the introductory video, this is the initial screen that you're shown, where you're asked to select the race of your character. The initial race of your character doesn't really make anything final. It dictates where you start off and your initial skill set, but you can cross-train into any skills. If you are a role player like myself, then it does dictate part of your backstory. It also dictates certain aspects of your appearance. For the purposes of this tutorial, I am going to pick Galente.
The only true democracy of New Eden, the Galente Federation is a powerful and prosperous multicultural dominion that welcomes outsiders with open arms. Intolerant of closed societies, the Galente are fierce defenders of personal and social liberties.
Once you've picked the race, you just click the next button in the lower right-hand corner. You then pick your bloodline and your gender. Again, this determines your appearance and if you are a role player, part of your backstory. For this tutorial, I will just choose the main Galente bloodline and a male character. The next step is that you need to create your full body avatar. The reason for this in a spaceship game is because CCP implemented part of a plan for your pilot to be able to walk around in stations whenever not actually flying around in a spaceship. That's been put on hold. Hopefully they will develop that feature further. But in anticipation of that, you do need to create a full body avatar, even though you may not necessarily be looking at it the vast majority of the time. So on your full body avatar, you can mouse over any given section and click and drag to alter that section in some manner. All right, so I can click and drag the cheekbones, move the lips up or down, and so on and so forth. You should go ahead and play with these options when you create your own character. You also have some menus up here. By the way, if you just want to change the overall shape of your character, you can make your character more muscular, less muscular, heavier, lighter, and there's a whole bunch of options that you can choose from here. I'm just going to go ahead and create a character real quick and not take up too much of your time with this process. Once you have finished creating a character on the stage, you can click Next in the lower right-hand corner. One thing that I forgot to mention is that with any of the options presented here, you can either left-click to center on that option, right, or you can left-click and drag to spin the options past. Of course, it's not quite significant here because there's only 9 choices. But on the next screen, that will be a bit more significant when you are trying to pick, say, a background of which there are 81 of them. So if you left click and drag here and let go, it'll spin past. Right. And if you want to keep track of which ones you might have liked, there is a number up here. So this is the 53rd out of 81 options. This is 52, 51, and so on and so forth. Right. Let's see, where's the Galente background? Here we go. Pick a pose. Let's light this up. And I like to have my character smiling. And then click the camera icon on one of the portraits here. There are four different portraits that you can take. I'm not exactly sure where each of the different ones are used, so I just use only one portrait. And then I click Next. It is worth pointing out that certain aspects of your character cannot be changed afterwards. There are some re-customization options. I'm not entirely sure what they are, but your race, bloodline, and gender cannot be changed after initial character creation. So if you care about your avatar's appearance, some people do, some people don't, then you probably want to take the time to get this part right. So on this screen, you choose your ancestry, which, if you're a role player, determines your backstory, but otherwise has no effect on the game. In years gone by, your ancestry and your education would have affected the rate at which you train different sorts of skills in the game, but now they're independent of these things. So your ancestry really doesn't matter for practical purposes, and your education only just narrows down further your starting location. Pilots who start in the Federal Navy Academy will start off, I think it's the Kuster Solar System. Center for Advanced Studies starts in Sistuver. I forget where University of Kai starts in. I'm going to pick Center for Advanced Studies. And in your name, you have two text fields here, right? Which is a first and middle name. This first field can take two words separated by one space. And the second field only takes one word, no spaces. So for example, if I put Dunhoo in the second field and tutorial space maker in the first field, what it's going to do is take this first field, add on a space, tack on the second field, and that's your name. So and this should turn out to be tutorial maker Dunhoo as three words. If you only want one word in your name, just leave the first field blank. If you want two words in your name, split the two words up between these two fields. Right. Click the Check Availability button to make sure that the character name is available and not in use by somebody else. And if you get a green check mark, you can finalize. All right, submit this picture as your portrait. And it will take you into the game. And here you are in station, in your station hangar. This is the default view. If you really like seeing your full body avatar further, you can click on Enter Captain's Quarters. Be forewarned, this is more graphics intensive, so if you don't have a particularly fast computer, then you may want to leave it alone, but you can walk around in your captain's quarters if you like. For the purposes of this tutorial, however, I'm just going to put us back in the Enter Ship Hangar view, which again is in the same spot here in the upper right corner. And this is the traditional hangar view. And let me straighten out my windows here a bit. I like to have my station surfaces take up the entire right-hand side of the screen. My local user list, which shows me who's in the solar system with me. And let me put that last chat channel window there. And the game will throw the first of the text tutorials at you in this window, which you can click and drag to reposition wherever it happens to be convenient. If you do actually decide to play the game, you can go ahead and read the text tutorials at your own pace. For the purposes of the video, though, I am going to try and take as little time with these as possible. Do be aware that these tutorials do sometimes create items for you, you being a new player. So you will want to actually cycle through all of the tutorials just to make sure that you get those. Right. But the first thing the game is going to ask you to do is to accept your first tutorial mission. So you click on the Agents tab of the Station Services window, you click on the Agents tab, you find Aura, you click the Start Conversation button. Alright? And this is a mission to fly to someplace, retrieve a ship that has been left for you there, and then get an item and bring it back here. I mean, supposedly it says to get an item and bring it back, but I don't actually see an item requirement for this mission, but anyway. So you click accept. We close. Hold on, let me get this tutorial window out of the way. And let's undock. By the way, if you need to review your missions, you have a journal here on the left-hand side. This bar on the left-hand side is your Neocom, and me playing on a Macintosh, I moused over a little bit too far and accidentally brought up the Macintosh OS system dock. Please ignore that. Please pay no attention to the man behind the curtain. So this is your Neocom bar on the left-hand side of the screen. You can right-click and align it to the right instead if you wish, if that makes you more comfortable. But I like to keep it on the left. All right. So you can click on the journal, and here you have accepted, agent is Aura, mission is covering the basics. You can right-click and then read details, and you can remind yourself on what the details are for your mission. So now, we are in space. Welcome to space. There's a lot of things in space. And zooming out, you can see there's quite a few things in space. Two ways to be aware of what's going on around you is to just pan your camera around, or orbit your camera around your ship. Just left click and drag on empty space. The mouse wheel will zoom in and out. Or if you need to zoom very quickly, you can hold down both the left and the right mouse button and push up or down. And that'll zoom a lot faster. The other way to be aware of what's around you in space is your overview. Yes, this is the first of the many of the infamous spreadsheets in space. But it's a very useful list because it tells you what or who is nearby you. For now, I'm just going to make this a large window with plenty of blank space. Eventually, I will have you add additional columns to your overview that you will find useful, but we're not going to worry about that right now. We also have the selected item box, which gives you options for interacting with the different things that you see around you in space. So I can left-click a station, and I can click the orbit button to orbit the station, right? Or I can click the show info button to get more information about a particular object, or I can left-click a person who is in space, and I can click approach to try and approach that person. Right. But we have a mission to do. Oh, by the way, there are different icons for different types of objects. This weird egg shape that you see is somebody in their capsule, not in an actual ship. These broken brackets are player ships. Their capsules are inside the ship. And a solid square bracket is a station. By the way, if you get tired of the camera constantly turning around to look at whatever you click on, you can press the C button on your keyboard to release the camera. That way you can select things on your overview without your camera going nuts. Right. We are on a mission, so let's get to it. So when you're on a mission, you can look in the upper left corner where it says Agent Missions, covering the basics, left click, and warp to location.
Warp drive active.
And if you are like me and you hate camera shake, you can go to the Escape menu, the Display and Graphics tab, the middle panel, and turn off Camera Shake. It's the fourth option from the top. And let's close window. You know what? because I have a good machine, I like to turn on the resource cache and use multi-threaded OpenGL, but that's just me. So now we're at the mission location, and we find the ship that has been left behind for us, right? And it is a Velator-type Galente frigate, a Galente rookie ship. You can tell that this is an abandoned ship because the name of the object is the same as the type of the object. If there was somebody in it, the name would be the name of the person, and there are no characters named Velator, I think. So you can board the ship by right-clicking on it in Overview and select Board Ship, or you can left-click on it in the Overview and click the Board Ship button from the selected item box. Or you can right-click on it directly in space, select Board Ship. Or you can hold down your left mouse button, and while holding down, shift your mouse up to select Board Ship. Any of those methods will work. Right. So whichever method you want to use for interacting with things, go ahead and use that method, whichever you're most comfortable with. Let's see. So now we need to go through an acceleration gate, so we right-click the gate and activate gate.
Warp drive active.
So the item we need to retrieve is inside that cargo rig. So let's click the cargo rig and open cargo. Now we're a bit too far away to do that. We need to be within 2,500 meters, and we started out about 6,000 meters away. So your ship will automatically approach first and then try to open the cargo rig. All right. And once it's open, it presents you with the inventory window. Now the inventory window is composed of a couple of sections. The left-hand section shows you the different types of inventory that you can currently access. Here we have Tutorial Maker Dunhu's Velator. So this is showing me the main cargo bay. We also have the drone bay from which I can launch robotic drones to go shoot my enemies. And we have the Galente cargo rig that I just accessed. I can loot this Freedom of Operation license either by clicking the Loot All button or just by dragging it to the row on the left-hand side that represents my cargo hold. In either case, I've now looted it, and we now go back to the station. Let's see. So we select the station, and we click Dock, and your ship will try to go to warp to the station. Now in this case, the cargo rig happens to be in my way, which brings up an excellent point here. In order for your ship to go to warp, your ship must be moving towards the destination at sublight speed, at least 75% of your current maximum sublight speed, and within about 8 degrees. But if something is in the way while you're trying to align to warp, you get bumped off course, you can't go into warp right away. All right. So as you see, or as you saw, rather, I kept bumping into the cargo rig, and my ship had to slowly make its way around in order to be able to go into warp. If I wanted to get out of the way manually, I could have hit Control Spacebar to abort my warp, and then double left click anywhere in space to go in that direction. I will probably demonstrate this the next time we undock. Now to complete a mission, you again go to the Agents tab, look for the agent that says Accepted, start conversation, and click the Complete Mission button. This is a green checkmark, so we finish the objective, so we complete the mission. In this particular case, the mission just simply had a completion flag, and it doesn't actually want the item that we picked up from it, which is unusual for retrieval missions. I'll show you an example of something that doesn't do that later. So we click the request mission to request a new mission from the agent. And what the agent wants us to do is to head to a location in space, destroy a fuel depot, then move on and destroy pirates in the next area. Right? Let's see. Now, at this point, the tutorial tells you about skills. This is very important. So let's go up to the top of the Neocom here. Right underneath your portrait, there is a black bar. If you mouse over it, it says open training queue, no skill in training. Now let's left click on that. That opens the training queue window. And did the game give us... The game was supposed to give us a skill book. Let's see if I can find it. Inventory. I click on item hanger. Here we go, repair systems. So when you're docked in a station and you open the inventory window and you get this thing, besides your ship's cargo hold and your drone bay from earlier, you also have the ship hangar and the item hangar. These represent your personal spaces inside the station. So this is the area in the station where you keep your ships, all of your ships, and this is the area in the station where you keep your items. Right? It's kind of sort of like a bank, except that each station hangar is different. So if I leave this station and go to a different station, my hangars there are going to be empty because I've never been there before. So I go to the item hangar, here's repair systems, I right click and inject skill. I happen to remember that the repair system skill is in the mechanics section, and we should train that up. So you left click and, hold on, let me do that a little more slowly. You left click and drag the skill from the left hand side to the right hand side, and then click apply. And that starts the skill training process, and it's going to take 8 minutes and 16 more seconds for repair systems level 1 to be trained. Right. And here's the thing about skills. In most games, in most MMOs, you become more powerful, you gain new abilities by going out and killing monsters, and you get XP just from the act, you get experience points just from the act of killing those monsters or doing quests or whatever. And when you level up, you get more abilities, or you can go to a skill trainer and pay a fee to get more abilities. It doesn't work like that in EVE Online. In EVE Online, you have to get a skill book. Your initial skill books will come from the tutorial missions or the tutorial windows themselves. Make sure you go through all of the tutorial windows that are presented to you as a new player. But most skill books that you're going to make use of, you have to buy from an NPC off the market. And I will demonstrate that in the next episode of How to Survive EVE Online. For now, though, we're just going to train up the skills that we were given. Let me take a look, see if there's anything else we want to put in here. Skill training is a background process. I don't have to be online or even doing anything to train these skills. Right? So if I left click and drag Galente Frigate over here, I'll start training level 3. If I drag it again, I'll start that queues up Galente Frigate level 3 and Galente Frigate level 4. I click apply to commit the change, and now it will follow that plan for the next 2 days, 49 minutes. So I could log off right now, go do something for the next 2 real days. It's Thursday night in the United States as I'm recording this. I could go do something else and come back Saturday night, and the skill queue training will be almost done. It's a background process. It'll happen while you're doing stuff, while you're not doing stuff, while you're online, offline, going to a movie, eating food, going to work, whatever. All right? Skill training is the single slowest process in EVE Online. You always, always want to have a skill in training at all times. So you'll want to check in at least once a day, unless you know that you've put in a 3-week skill, to make sure that your skill training, you're training something. All right. So I'm going to double click. So I'm going to click apply. Make sure I have that committed. Close that. I have already requested the next mission. Or did I? And you know what? I may have skipped ahead in the. Ah, yes, of course. The tutorial window gives us some new equipment. I'd forgotten about that. So I'm going to open the fitting window from this button right underneath the envelope. By the way, you can change the order of these buttons if you want by left-clicking and dragging them around on the Neocom. If you misplace something, if you made a button go away, you can find it again from the Eve menu, and you can drag it in. So here's the fitting window. This shows you your current ship and its statistics. For now, though, all we need to do is fit on the light electron blaster and the civilian armor repair. And that is all we need to worry about for now. We're going to close the fitting window, close the inventory, and I am pretty sure. Oh, you know what? Abort undock. Accept the mission. Close, then undock. And you'll notice the background lights went out as you started the undocking process. If you forget something, you can click that undock button again to abort, like I just did, because I'm an absent-minded professor. So we are now in space. We're gonna right. I can right-click in empty space and go to Agent Missions, Combat Basics, Encounter Said Space Warp to Location, or I can go up here and click Warp to Location. Either method works.
Warp drive active.
By the way, that bit about skill training. Each episode takes me about an hour to film and then another 3 hours of processing and probably some additional time to upload it. So I can't shoot these out in rapid succession, unfortunately, because of real life commitments that I do have to attend to. So between episodes, you may find that for me, an entire day has passed, so I've been in doing an entire day's worth of skill training in between episodes. If you're going through this at a much quicker pace, because you don't have to slow down the way I do, you may find you're running slightly into skill issues. So here I am, I'm gonna jump through the acceleration gate.
Warp drive
All right, the tutorial spawned antimatter charges for our weapon. By the way, if you're in space when the tutorial window gives you stuff, it will appear in your cargo hold. If you're in station, it will appear in your station item hangar. So right-click the weapon, click antimatter charge. A hybrid weapon's going to take 5 seconds to load. Lasers are instant. Projectiles and missiles will take 10 seconds. And we can either right-click this thing and lock target, but for target locking in particular, I like to do control left-click. That's the quick way to do it. And I'm going to push F1 on my keyboard to start shooting. Now, when we target locked the thing, we got a portrait of it, and it's showing us its 3 health bars. And now that it has exploded, the tutorial is going to make our ship take damage, and our 3 health bars are going to go down. And our 3 bars are shield, armor, and structure, and these are the same for any ship in EVE Online. Or any NPC in EVE Online for that matter. So, as a Galente, I've taken armor damage, so I'm gonna run the armor repair and start patching that up. We need to get through the next acceleration gate. Oh, right, I promised to show you manual navigation. I can double left click in empty space, and I will start manually flying in that direction. Double left click in a different direction, I will start flying in that direction. Both of these directions happen to be closer to the acceleration gate. So as you can see, I am now within activation range of the gate. You'll see that I'm 0 meters away from the acceleration gate. Certain big objects have an imaginary sphere at which you are considered 0 distance away from the gate. All right, my armor is patched up. I'm going to turn off that armor module, and I am going to activate gate.
Warp drive active.
Now, these little red crosses indicate hostile NPCs that you can shoot at. Control left click to target lock it. I can control left click either in the overview or in space, either method works. I am going to click approach. My weapon, if I mouse over it. Ah, repair assistance level 1 is complete. Let me push F1 to start shooting. So I've taken down his shields, I've taken down his armor, now it's into structure, and it starts blinking to indicate that it's been destroyed. There's a new target, control left click. It's 12 kilometers away. If I mouse over my module, I notice that optimal plus fall off is 2,000 meters. So I'm not going to have a good chance of hitting that thing if it's more than 2,000 meters away. I'll have a chance, it'll just be small. Alright. Both enemies are dead. Let's return to the station. And while we are at it, I am going to press Control R on my keyboard to reload the weapon, and you'll see the weapon icon blinking to indicate that it's in the process of reloading, and it goes back up to 200. So, unless you're using Amarian lasers, the weapon that you are using uses charges, and you have to have the ammunition for it. You can carry additional ammunition in your cargo hold, but more ammunition takes up more space, and you might need empty cargo hold. You might need empty cargo space for some reason.
Docking permission requested. Docking.
All right, start conversation. We're going to complete the mission, and we were given a small armor repair as a reward. And all right, let me open the inventory window. Something I like to do as a personal preference. With the inventory window open, I'm going to hold down the shift key and single click item hanger. That brings up the item hanger as a separate window. And let me rearrange these the way I like, otherwise I am going to go batty. Shift, left click, same with the ship hanger. Hold on. Sorry, give me a moment. I'm probably a bit OCD about how I like my windows set up. There we go. Original size and in position. So I like to keep my ship hanger and my item hanger as separate windows, and if I double left click on my ship in the station, I get my active ship hanger, my active ship cargo hold. Now I have three different windows, and I can click drag back and forth without confusing myself as to what is where. Let me open the fitting window. I'm going to pull out the civilian armor repair, and let's fit a real armor repair this time. Alright, close the fitting window. I'm going to request the next mission. And here, we need to retrieve something and bring it back to station. Alright. So we have an objective to complete in the solar system Aletta, and we have an item that we need to bring back to this station, Systover 5, Moon 12, Center for Advanced Studies School. We know that's exactly where we are right now, because that's the station name in the upper left corner. Systover 5, Moon 12, Center for Advanced Studies School. By the way, you can always left-click any of these things, the system, constellation, the region, the station, for additional information. You can also right-click these things for a context menu. There are a lot of things that can be right-clicked in EVE Online. But I'm going to accept this mission. Drop this off, I don't need it. I am going to right-click Aletta, set destination. I'm going to right-click the station and add waypoint because I am going to come right back. Let me cycle through these tutorial windows. I already queued up Galente Frigate 3 and 4. Alright, let's undock. All right, so now that we are back in space, you'll notice that some of these icons in the overview are in yellow. These indicate objects that either are part of your autopilot route or lead to some section of your autopilot route. I need to go to Aletta, and Aletta happens to... Somebody just launched probes. Aletta happens to be a yellow stargate. So I'm going to right-click and select jump. Now I need to be within 2,500 meters to jump through a stargate.
Warp drive active.
So I got to warp over there first. And warping through solid objects is perfectly fine. Your ship does not go boom from colliding with anything. Now your ship has three main primary means of getting around. The sublight engines to get from point to point in a short distance, your warp drive to go between distances in a solar system, and stargates to get to the next solar system. These aren't the only methods of moving around. There are other methods that will move your ship, but I'm not going to cover them in this particular series. Oh, and for those of you who have been away from EVE Online for quite some time, check this out. That is the new Stargate animation. CCP just implemented it in Odyssey just now. So now we're in the next solar system. I'm going to right-click empty space, agent missions, the academy, encounter, warp to location. Again, I could have gone to the upper right-hand corner and clicked on the academy, then clicked on warp to location. Or read details or start conversation with the agent, whichever it is that I wanted to do. And again, the item that you need to retrieve is inside an object, represented by a diamond. And dropping out of warp. And there's the Galente Academy office. Right click. Galente Academy office, you can right-click from the overview and open cargo. If you try to right-click on it directly, it'll still work. Excellent. So you can also right-click on it in space and open cargo. That also works. Alright, I click the loot all button, and we now have our pilot certification document. And the game is going to tell you about the look at command. You can click on anything in your overview and click the look at button. Let me get the window out of the way. And you can center your camera on that particular object rather than on your own ship. Alright, and I can look at any of these things. I could also target lock them if I wanted to, but I don't want to shoot at anything, so I'm going to leave that alone. So I'm going to right click, unlock target, and let me reset my camera. So now I'm looking at myself again. Alright, we're done with the look at command. Let's go back to Sistavir. Sometimes looking at something is very useful because different players will fit out different ships in different ways. And you can see, you can get an idea for what they have fit to their ship if you use the look at command on their ship. So if you're going up against a ship that normally uses turrets, that normally uses turreted weapons, but you're looking at it and there are no turrets on it, something's got to be occupying those slots. So it may be up to something. Like maybe it's got a full set of smart bombs with which it's doing area of effect damage all around it, and it's just waiting for you to get foolishly closer. So sometimes you look at is useful for more than just staring at the pretty art. left click on the station, and click dock. If you have a station set as a waypoint or a destination, then the station will be colored yellow when you arrive in system. For those of you who have been away from EVE Online for quite some time, yes, this is new. You can set a station as a destination or waypoint. By the way, the only difference between set destination and add waypoint is that set destination will wipe out all your existing waypoints, and then add that thing as your one and only waypoint. So if you've got this long, complicated route with a whole bunch of waypoints set, be very careful about set destination. By the way, I just realized that I left it implied, but you do have an autopilot, and when you set destination or add waypoint, the autopilot will figure out a route for you, and it's the autopilot that colors the Stargates yellow to indicate where you need to go next, according to your own route. Oh, by the way, this blue icon here, which is just shown here for demonstration purposes, this is the show info button. Wherever you see the show info button, you can left click on it to show information on whatever object it's associated with. All right, so just keep that in mind. Let's see. We're already back in station. Let's complete the mission. And it took the pilot certification documents away from us. And we're going to request the next mission. And this is a courier mission. We're going to take clearance papers from here to another station in Clelanon. So we're going to right-click Clelanon 6 Moon 11 Center for Advanced Study School and set destination. We're going to accept. That spawns the clearance papers in our cargo hold. I'm going to double left-click on my ship. Left-click the first object, shift-left-click the last object that selects everything in between. I'm going to drag it all into my cargo hold. I'm taking everything with me because I am not coming back here. The rest of the series will take place in Clelanon. So I'm going to close, and I'm going to undock. Now the game is going to tell you about another feature of your autopilot. Besides plotting a route for you, you can also let the autopilot fly your ship. So if I click the A button down here, that engages the autopilot. And if I wait a little bit, it will warp us to Stargate Aletta.
Warping to Stargate.
Now, if I leave it alone, it will fly my ship all the way to the station in Clelanon. There is a problem with the autopilot. If the autopilot initiates a warp to a station or stargate, it's going to drop out of warp 15 kilometers short of the target, which means that you have to spend the rest of your time slowboating those last 15 kilometers before you actually jump or dock. Now, I'm in high security space, and I'm in an NPC corporation, and nobody can declare war on an NPC corporation. I will explain wars at the end of the series. But any player who tries to shoot at me unprovoked is going to be destroyed by the Concord police. This may not necessarily happen fast enough to save my ship, but the aggressors will be destroyed. Now, I'm not carrying anything valuable in my cargo hold, so it's not worth anybody's time to try and destroy my ship. There are modules called cargo scanners. People can target lock you and scan your cargo hold, see what you have on board, and try to decide if you're worth destroying, facing the Wrath of Concord to blow up. These are suicide gankers, right? They destroy your ship, they get destroyed by Concord, and then the accomplice who never fired a shot idles on up to your wreck, swipes everything that survived off the wreckage, sells it on the market, and splits the proceeds with the gankers who actually destroyed your ship. And if you're autopiloting, you're slowboating these last 15 kilometers to every Stargate and 15 kilometers to the station. I do not advise allowing the autopilot to fly your ship unless you're quite certain that you have no problems with losing whatever it is that's on board your ship and your capsule. So I'm just gonna warp normally and manually the rest of the way. Now the tutorial tells you about medical clones. Alright? Medical clones are a very important thing. Remember when I said skill training is a very slow process? You will slowly accumulate skill points over time. As a new pilot, you're only going to have about 50,000, 60,000 skill points or so. Right? If your ship is destroyed, your capsule, that egg-shaped thing that you started off with at the start of the game, will be automatically ejected from your ship, and you can try to warp your capsule out of there to get away from danger as quickly as possible. NPCs aren't going to destroy your capsule, but players might. And if your capsule is destroyed, your capsule will inject your brain with a deadly neurotoxin and scan your brain with a device that will read every single neuron in your brain and send that information to a waiting medical clone. And you will awaken in a new body. Oh, did I forget to mention that you're immortal? Yes, that's how your immortality is implemented. When you die, your consciousness is transferred to a new body. But of course, whether or not that body contains all the skills that your old body has depends upon your medical clone. You always get a clone grade alpha for free, which covers 900,000 skill points. But if you are pod killed while your medical clone is out of date, say you had 1 million skill points and you only covered 900,000 and you were pod killed, that's 100,000 in excess. You lose 5% of the excess. So of that 100,000 excess, you lose 5,000 skill points. So you go from 1 million skill points down to 995,000 skill points. That might not sound like a big deal, but if you get to be an old player like me and you have tens of millions of skill points, you really do not want to forget to update your medical clone. Right? Because losing 5% of 100 million skill points is 5 million skill points, that's a bit more painful. So always make sure that your medical clone is up to date. The other thing that it tells you about is looking for player corporations who are recruiting people. I'm not going to go into depth about that, and being biased, I will have opinions on that at the end of the episode. If you're listening. Gives you more reading about skills. Let's actually dock.
Docking permission requested. Docking request accepted.
Alright. I am going to start conversation with Aura. And I have the clearance papers. Everything here is green check marks. I picked it up from the station. I have it at the drop-off location. I have the cargo. Alright, so if I click complete mission, that despawns the clearance papers from my cargo hold. Alright. By the way, you can always left-click any of these icons in the mission briefing to show info on that object in question. You might need to wait a bit for the show info window to finish loading. So I'm going to close that, and we are done with the initial series of tutorial missions, and here we have a whole list of new tutorial chains that we can get started on. All right. Let's see, are there anything? Yeah, it pops up. So the tutorial window pops up this other window. Click done, and we are done with that. All right. So, that covers the initial tutorial chain. In the next episode of EVE Online, we are going to get started with the exploration chain. All right. For now, though, I am going to end this episode here. Thank you for watching.